looking back at the past and why we had to be back on stage. So coming next will be the Fireside Chat with Kevin and Samson. Everyone knows Kevin is the co-founder and former CEO of Twitch, and he now is having his own startups again that's called Meta Theory. So coming up, we'll talk about Metaverse, Web3, and also crypto to explore, to take you guys to explore the new world. So let's welcome Kevin and Samson. Let's give them a big pause. Well, I know if you really love me.
You're doing okay. Thank you all for coming to talk to us today. Everybody here will know Kevin here as the co-founder of Twitch. So Kevin, you achieved the goal of all founders. You made it out the other side. You did okay for yourself. You were investing. You were watching a lot of YouTube. You then decided to return to the life of a founder and launch Meta Theory. Why did you do this?
I left Twitch last November, so just over a year ago. Came to Taiwan with my parents, largely to escape COVID and give them, you know, some reprieve from that experience in San Francisco. And essentially started to feel after 6 months like I was kind of a waste of space. Like I wasn't doing anything interesting. I wasn't contributing to anything meaningful. And just got the itch again. A lot of conflating factors. I think, you know, partially I missed my friends in the games industry. I missed working with creators. I missed doing something. I missed working with a team. I think that was the actual core of it, was I missed working with a group of people with some purpose, whether, you know, completely arbitrarily made, and decided to try to do something and started to just think through, what have I always wanted to do? And there were two things that kind of squished together. One was I've always wanted to make a video game. The other was I've always wanted to make an anime. I'm a huge anime fan. And I had these two ideas brewing in my mind for years and decided to squish them together as one company, convinced one of my best college buddies to join me. And then a former coworker from Twitch as our CTO to join, and a bunch of other friends to join that I've worked with in the past, or actually some of which I recently met here in Taiwan, to start something new. Decided on Web3 gaming blockchain because I'm fascinated by the space. Think it's a good opportunity to rebuild something better for all of us through the internet, and particularly interested in Taiwan because I love Taiwan. My family's from here. I feel very connected to the space. I feel there's very talented, incredibly talented people here. And so, yeah, thought I'd give it a shot.
All right, so what is Meta Theory and what are you really trying to achieve?
So Meta Theory is the easy descriptor, thanks to Silicon Valley, is it is a Web3 game company, which means we are a game company that builds on top of blockchain. So I think the term is a little bit confusing for a lot of people. It's maybe even just overcomplicated in itself. We're just building video games that use a different data architecture that allow for ownership of in-game assets and ownership of the coins and so on and things that you earn by playing these video games. But at the core, we're an IP game company, right? Building on the blockchain technology. Yes, we have to have expertise in the blockchain. We have to have engineers that can build on the blockchain. But at the end of the day, the experience we are trying to create is fun, engaging gameplay built around a universe, a story that develops over time.
So that sounds like one of the big buzzwords in blockchain, crypto, and gaming right now, which is play to earn. Is this a play to earn?
We're aiming to build this, yes. Very, very subtle difference. We like to think of it as play and earn, as in you can play at the core. That's the most important part of it. There's not the two mechanism is a little looser in the sense that we're focused on good gameplay at the core, engaging social experiences at the core, with these earning mechanisms that you can create value for yourself over time, or you know, you and your friends over time as you play these video games, versus a lot of the there's this, you know, gap period, so to speak, where people are transitioning from building in Web 2 versus Web 3, which is sort of this halvesy way. We're sort of stuck in this position as well, where you're building on top of, you know, these new sort of financial systems of crypto. So a lot of the games that are being built are first decentralized finance protocols, as in they have you exchange fiat for a token, you stake that token, you can farm for more tokens, you can lend those tokens, et cetera, and on top of that is essentially a graphical interface that is fun in some cases, not so fun in other cases, but the whole purpose is to participate in that decentralized protocol for finance. Ours is gameplay first, earning mechanism on top of that, right? Ideally for us, we're trying to build long-term sustainable token design so that it's, you know, it grows steadily over time. It's carefully planned. To be honest, we don't no idea what we're doing. We're figuring it out as we go. We're talking to a lot of economists and you know, political scientists and so on that sort of understand how these systems have been built in the past. But a lot of what's being built today is very short-term thinking. And in fact, most of the economies that you see in crypto now do not function like real-world economies. As in, if you think of money as a commodity, which is erroneous, by the way, but a lot of people think of it that way. Let's use steel as an example. When the price of steel goes down, what happens? Typically, construction goes up. People build more cars because the price of materials is lower, so the demand goes up. When the price goes up, the reverse happens. In crypto, they don't really function that way. And so you don't really see that behavior. When a price goes down, oftentimes that's related to activity going up, as in more people are generating tokens in these games, and so the price decreases, and so inflation there's a huge inflationary problem. When the price goes back down, you'd think people would start to do more stuff, but in fact that's not what's happening. And so how do you design a system that is more reflective of the real world so that when people go into it, they have a better grasp and understanding of it because it more reflects real life? And I think you're starting to see systems that look like that, but they're not quite there yet.
So you briefly touched upon it there. So NFTs in gaming are not universally welcomed. There was huge backlash when Ubisoft revealed Quartz, its NFT platform to buy and sell equipment in Ghost Recon. Serious gamers already invest a lot of time in a game, but when players are incentivized not to have a good time first, but to make as much money as possible, you know, essentially the economy comes first, and enjoyment and artistic value often come second. Is there a risk that developers are putting themselves first ahead of their gamers?
Oh, sure. I mean, the traditional publisher model is quite greedy. It's quite expensive of a system. So if you think about the last time there was a paradigm shift was going from premium box sales to free-to-play. That took a decade to adopt because a lot of the existing publishers, Activision, EA, et cetera, even Ubisoft, although I will say Ubisoft is one of the most progressive, in my opinion, most progressive game companies on the planet outside of Asia. Asia is quite progressive. Huge resistance from both the industry and the audience. The industry thought free-to-play was, it was too risky. As in, you previously could convince someone to buy a $60 game, spend your $60 up front, unknowing at all how the game is going to play out. This was when journalism and reviews came through magazines, and so you had this huge lag effect of, well, I can make hundreds of millions of dollars selling a crappy game just by putting together, you know, some good assets and some good trailers, which, by the way, is in fact what's happening in NFT gaming right now, right? If for those of you who are participating in there, actually show of hands, who's like bought NFTs or played NFT games? Okay, not that many. You're not too late, but congratulations on skipping a lot of the bullshit part. People just make these little trailers, and suddenly people get super excited because it's more than what most people do. That's in fact how premium games were sold. Then came franchising. Right now you have a system in place, you have a team, you have IP, you have a storytelling device, you have all these systems design mechanisms, and it's very easy to rinse and repeat. That's why there's like 15 Call of Duties now and so many Assassin's Creeds and so on. Once there's a hit, once there's an IP hit, rinse and repeat, rinse and repeat. Would you call it abusive? I don't know. Is it still fun? Sure. I think in many cases it's still fun, and if people have a emotional attachment to that IP and thus it's successful. But it's a very expensive system. They spend hundreds of millions of dollars marketing these games. Switch to free-to-play. free-to-play now is free-to-play. You can jump into a game risk-free as a user, and in theory, the game companies are hoping one day that you will spend money in that game for one reason or another, the most common being cosmetics. Historically, there's been more abusive systems like pay-to-win, as in you buy golden bullets that are better than normal bullets, and the more money you spend, the higher you rank, and that's arbitrary, right? The reason to spend money is completely arbitrary. I want to be on the leaderboard in this community, right? This is a metaverse, by the way. Video games are basically metaverses, which is a very misunderstood and overabused term. So that was free to play, and the most acceptable system as that system evolved just over the last decade, right? Really, League of Legends being the biggest free to play game on the planet outside of China, is all essentially cosmetics driven. There are some aspects of buying, you know, items to earn experience faster and get better faster, but at a certain point, as you play the game, you can earn your way to basically being on roughly equal standing with everybody else. So the cosmetics is the system. Fortnite then followed as the next biggest one that really launched gaming into the mainstream, strictly cosmetics. You paid $9 at a time to look like Marshmallow or some other famous thing, or just some random asset that the company Epic made. So that took 10 years for the industry to truly adopt. Web3 is yet more confusing for many reasons. Ubisoft is getting called out largely for a lot of what's misunderstood about the blockchain space, which is energy utilization. Yes, Ethereum and Bitcoin are very expensive. They're unsustainable as a transaction mechanism for video games, where you require high velocity and high volume of transactions on a daily basis if you are successful as a video game. That's both expensive for everybody, but it's also taxing on the energy system. Now you've got different proof protocols like Solana, like Polygon, like Immutable, where they're proof of stake or proof of something else that doesn't require all this compute power work to memorialize things on the blockchain. And so that's just a misunderstanding. That's a lot of marketing that's been done in the last few years about blockchain, that it is expensive and it's destroying the world. There are many other things that are destroying the world. Yes, it is contributing to that, right? Bitcoin, Ethereum, that it is contributing to energy utilization. But the trade-off is the benefit. It's a new financial system that is, in theory, more fair for people, more open, more permissionless, more trusted. It is permissionless in most cases. And so that's the trade-off. But people don't understand that side of it. So that's one thing. The other thing is it feels greedy. Just like once free-to-play and the cosmetic system really evolved, people felt it was greedy because now you cannot spend you can spend more than $60 playing the game. And so that's high-level detail. There's all these little nuanced things like DLC, downloadable content that premium games do to make more money, map sales, and so on. Like new versions of the game, more subtle versions of the game that were for sale to make more money. That were, again, I wouldn't say abusive, but the misunderstanding is that NFT is a money grab. When really, in theory, done right, you own the assets in the game. If you decide to abandon the game today in a normal game, in a free-to-play game, you lose everything. You can maybe sell the account to somebody, but that's unofficial and technically illegal by most game company standards. In the NFT world, well, if I decide I don't want to play Fortnite anymore, I can sell off individual assets to people and hopefully make my money back, or maybe even make some money on that.
So what are you doing at MetaTheory to avoid, you know, what some gamers might view as, if it's not too strong a word, like feeling abused by the developer?
Yeah, this is the ultimate quest. I mean, like, I think that this is a constantly evolving thought. For now, we want to make free-to-play games. We did do an NFT drop, which means, you know, people that were supporters of ours, of our early community, that bought things from us that in theory they will use in these games in the future will benefit. You know, a lot of the way that, you know, there's many benefits to that. Largely for now, it's community. It's getting to participate in a community. It's being able to contribute to everything from the story to game development to character creation to just what do we do as a company? And that is this really interesting difference in this world versus the previous world. I won't claim that we're perfectly decentralized as a business, right? We're still learning our way through that because the reality is building stuff is difficult. And when you have, the more voices you have when you're building something as a startup stage, the more difficult it is, right? Community by design is like, it just doesn't really work. But you can process the feedback. And so if you have a good feedback processing mechanism and then you can turn that into decision making, great. That's what we're trying to do. And so that is sort of the reward, so to speak, or the reason, so to speak, this early sort of membership access to this small community that is all building together. That's why you would sort of buy into some of these projects in the beginning. Now, over time, what we want to do is make free-to-play games. We want anyone to be able to come into our game and start to build up a character, build up a set of assets, and earn value over time as a result. So ground up, open to everybody. A lot of Web3 games right now are gated by pay. You have to buy. You have to buy assets in order to play at all, which is what resulted in this guild system now. So in the Web3 game world, you've got the game company. Then you've got what they call guilds, yield guilds. Yield Guild Gaming is one of the biggest. There's many, many, many others around the world. In fact, a lot of individuals are guilds. What guilds do is they buy up assets. They're basically McDonald's. They go and buy a bunch of real estate, and then they franchise you and teach you how to do the thing. And in the case of Axie Infinity, which is the first true free-to-play game that is at scale. And by the way, scale, for those of you who don't know, they transact, I think their peak transaction was almost $1 billion in a month on the secondary market. And this game is only, the company's only about 3 years old. The game's only been popular since roughly March of this year. And so that's how fast these systems are building these days. That's how fast companies can earn revenue these days. But the point is now there's this layer of this lending mechanism essentially that is built on top of this new type of system. I think that'll work for us too, as in, we will work with guilds, we will work with guild-like systems, but for us, we are going to allow anyone to come in to play for free.
And will there be a token attached to all of this? Like, how are people going to get assets in and out?
Yeah. So right now we have one token, which is the NFT, the non-fungible token, which is the profile picture asset, as they call it, the PFP that you buy. That's the genesis. That's essentially the Kickstarter group, right? They've now come in and said, cool, we like this project, we want to support it, and they spent money to now participate in the future development of everything that we do. Yes, we will have to have a token. We will have to have a fungible token that you can earn. This is how most of these systems work right now. It is not unlike traditional games design. Traditional games in the free-to-play system have some sort of in-game currency that you use. Oftentimes you're trading fiat for, you're trading cash for, to buy in-game assets. And so we're being very thoughtful about what that systems design looks like, all the different game loops, all the different engagement points within the game, and then, from there, extrapolating out what is the best possible token economy system we can build on top of that.
So one of the issues with NFTs and crypto in general is assessing value, right? And it's based on demand without often an underlying real world use case or value. There is value in an asset as long as there are more and more people lining up to acquire it. So how does that work in gaming, and what happens when nobody wants to play your game anymore?
We get really sad at that point. I think that this is the ultimate question, right? I think fundamentally, successful games are fun. They're just fun. They're engaging, and they have high retention. And there are many reasons for those two things. Retention, social is a big part of it. What is that social system within the game? Is it a competitive game? Is it a cooperative game? It's funny because in this space, the hardest thing I've had to think through all this is like you're inventing an economy. Every game is inventing an economy, and so you as the game designers have to figure out, okay, what are the points in those economy? What are the actions in that world that beget currency? That beget in-game currency? It feels weird. Having played many games, I realize that as you jump into those games, you just kind of understand it, right? Good games do a good job onboarding you onto that system so you fundamentally understand it. Meanwhile, most people in the world don't even understand how to manage their own money, right? Basic accounting is not something most people are taught, which is weird. But video games teach you sort of, in-game money management. When do you spend to buy armor versus speed versus dexterity, right? Or a new weapon. They're very complex, actually. And so really the key is to design something that's fun around a complex system that is complex enough that it's interesting, but still easy enough to understand. And then, from there it's really audience, it's user acquisition. How does that work? It's continued marketing. How do you keep people in the game? And that's where like those important social mechanisms come in. Is it fun? There's all these dopamine hits in games. Everything from sound effects to lighting and sort of environmental effects are really critical to that feeling of excitement in game. It's very complicated, right? Games are one of those. It's the perfect storm of everything. You need great technology. You need great art. You need great storytelling. You need great sound. It's almost a full sensory experience. Minus smell of vision, I guess, which is maybe coming in the future. I have no idea. I don't know if I want to play a game and smell things while I'm doing it. I'm not sure yet. It's hard. That is a hard question, and that's why, you know, of the 30,000 games or so that are made every single month and pushed to the various app stores, only a few survive.
When you announced the launch of MetaTheory, you said that Web3 is an opportunity for society to discover and embrace a new paradigm in control, access, and participation. So what is decentralization going to do for the internet?
In general. I mean, this is, not to be dramatic, but this is sort of our last chance to escape this Web2 system that's gone awry, right? Right now, our phones, our computers are there to capture your attention. And there are many reasons for this, one of which is advertising. The over-reliance on advertising as a business model is causing this. Facebook, Google being the biggest culprits. They want your time. And most people know this, you don't get a lot of satisfaction from that. Sure, there's connectivity, right? There are lots of good things about the internet today in terms of communication and connection and developing online community. But there are many bad things about it. And I think that's a lot of that is related to the incentive system that we were built on. You know, even with Twitch, we were built originally on advertising as a revenue stream. Thankfully, because we talked to our creators, we realized that people actually would pay each other for free content. That was our biggest light bulb moment. From our creators, they said, we think, because we already see this behavior, people donate to us on PayPal, on all these random widgets that break, as in, PayPal, oftentimes, if you're a creator on Twitch and in other places, but I'll just use Twitch as the example, you get all these donations on PayPal, and PayPal says, hey, this looks like fraud. You don't get your money. But it was real. It was people really donating them money. And so from that feedback, we decided to build the subscription system. And that's a $5 a month system. It didn't even remove ads. You still had to watch ads. But it was a patronage mechanism, right? The 90% reason why people paid $5 a month for content you could watch for free. We had nothing that was truly pay-gated. Everything on the website was free. People would pay $5 a month out of the feeling of giving back to that creator. You are my entertainer of choice. I love you. I'm excited to be part of your community. Here's my $5. And then we built a what we call Bits, which is a virtual currency system. So you can now donate one penny at a time to a creator. And so we luckily kind of had this transitory system where we weren't overly obsessed with advertising. It's a high margin business, right? Advertising is a very high margin business for platforms, which is why it's so dominant as a business model. That's why even companies like Amazon are getting into advertising, because it is such a high margin business. But that has ruined really our experience. You know, people get trapped in these systems. They lose a lot of their time. They're sacrificing time and often money as well, because the current internet is largely designed to keep you there, focused on whatever it is they want you to focus on, and ultimately spend money. Decentralization means that you don't have these walled gardens of information. You don't have the Googles and Facebooks of the world that are aggregating every little detail about you and reselling it to advertisers, which means that Facebook's job, Google's job, Twitter's job is to maintain you, to keep you coming every single day so that they can force your eyeballs to look at whatever it is that people are paying them want you to look at. This is an opportunity to change that system. Crypto really is the hottest topic, I think, in the blockchain world. Blockchain is really just a data system, you know, new data architecture. A lot of people don't talk about that. Like some people are starting to build the Twitter, the Reddit, the Facebook, the X, the Web2X of blockchain, which in theory is now built on a system that doesn't rely on advertising, because there's a natural currency system within it, or at least around it, that you can use to transact and share with. So now, if you are successful as a creator, in theory on Web3, people just give you money. People just give you tokens. You earn it by earning not attention, but more passion, right? More like, I like what this person's saying, I like what this person's doing, I like what this person's created, just take my money directly. And you cut out all these middlemen as a result.
And how long before we see Web3 being the dominant form of the internet?
Ooh, I don't, oh gosh, a while. I mean, well, people are building really fast. I mean, the space is moving at light speed. The problems that we're facing, that this industry is facing, I'm new to the industry, right? So I can't really, I love it, and I think the people I've met are incredibly helpful and nice, but I'm new to the industry. I'd say the problem they've been facing, and now I'm joining them in facing, is there's a lot of fraud, there's a lot of scam, and the user experience sucks. The user experience sucks. Like, buying crypto generally is not a pleasant experience. Transferring it around, even buying NFTs, is just like so complex. When we launched ours, many of my friends from the games industry and so on, it was their first time buying Ethereum and then transferring it to MetaMask and then going to our web, you know, going to the website buying the thing. I'd literally call them. I was like, dude, it's a 15-minute phone call. It's like, here's what you do, do this, do that. It's like even the user experience is so basic. Even communicating with our users is hard because Discord, for instance, is an amazing product. It is a metaverse in itself, right? These communities live and breathe in Discord, which is cool in a sense, but there's a lot of fraud there. It's an anonymous system, and so it's very easy for someone to impersonate someone else and steal all your stuff. And so you can't even message. We have to tell our users, we'll never message you within Discord. That's how basic it is, right? That's how little true trusted technology has been built in Web3 today. The speed of development will be fast. The adoption is going to be, the marketing to the mainstream to get people to trust this system that has a lot of bad press, a lot of distrust, a lot of brain damage from horrible experiences. It's getting them over the hurdle, right? And so the problem is right now in this whirlwind of money that's flowing into the blockchain space is a lot of bad actors, a lot of bad builders are just there to take money. And it's very easy to take money. If you think about it, if you want to launch an NFT in roughly a couple of days, you can pay someone on Fiverr or any other service a few $1,000s to make roughly 200 art assets, use open source software to randomize those assets onto each other as layers to make pretty pictures, and list them on the internet to sell for roughly $200 to $300 to $400 a piece. And as long as you do a good job marketing, or you know one influencer, chances are you're going to make a couple million bucks, and then you can cut and run, and no one knows. And that is, in fact, most people's experience in NFTs. And the reason why NFTs are interesting is because now, more than ever, people are onboarding onto crypto. Why? Celebrities are buying NFTs. Your favorite celebrity, chances are, they bought an NFT and they've marketed it. And so now, if you're an average consumer, a mainstream consumer, you're like, oh, cool, this must be like a legit thing. And that's why there's all this excitement around that. And so it's broken into the mainstream. Unlike DeFi, which is confusing, even more confusing, but people made a lot of money in it, but it also was full of fraud and scams and bad actors. But NFTs now, because it's a very understandable, almost tangible, digitally tangible object of a picture, and a club that I can join by being in this Discord with these cool people, people are starting to finally onboard. So how long? I don't know. Long-winded answer. I think within 3 to 5 years, you're going to see some really interesting stuff.
So in venture capital and Wall Street, the traditional, you know, bastions of finance, they're finally taking crypto seriously. VCs pumped around $30 billion into cryptocurrencies in 2021. That was more than all previous years combined. So have you been talking to any big names interested in throwing money your way?
Yes, I'm fortunate to be friends with many of these folks through my experience in Silicon Valley at Twitch, many of them are investors as direct angels, not as funds. We've been talking to them. I think there's a lot of money and VCs are deploying faster than ever. So anyone out there interested in raising money, regardless of whether you're building in Web3 or not, it's a really good time to do so. Valuations are a bit crazy, which makes it largely untenable, I think. It's clearly a bubble. Most of these companies are going to fail. A lot of tokens that are launched very quickly are going to fail. But what's weird about it is, and I think the reason for the excitement and the reason why everybody and their mother has a crypto fund of some sort or another now is, if you get in at a seed round, there's a decent chance, like, you'll, even if you miss the mark by 10x or 100x, you're still in the black, which is very bizarre by comparison to traditional tech investing, where it's either zero or, you know, your average VC return on an annual basis is roughly 20% or so. You can launch a meme coin in a matter of days or even hours, and get, you know, 10x that return. And so I think that's the excitement, but it's also froth. It's also kind of insane that it's happening.
And so just finally, just switching things back to Taiwan, what does Taiwan need to do to play a significant role in Web3?
Gosh. Where do I start? I think we talked about this earlier. I think the fundamental thing is funding. I think Taiwan has an issue with seed funding. Very risk averse culture, very, very conservative money management culture. It's not that there isn't seed funding, but in my experience talking to entrepreneurs here, and I've been coming here my whole life, and I've spent the last year here, and I've been coming here for roughly 10 years for Twitch, and I always try to meet with founders just to see what's going on. The investment landscape here, if you are successful, if, which is a big if, as in there's a low probability you can raise seed funding from local people, is they take too much equity. And so the expectation at a seed round is 30 to 50%. Which means if I raise, and that's not even for a lot of money. That's for maybe 1 year run rate, right? That's like a $50,000 to $100,000 raise, maybe sometimes $250,000 to $300,000. But I've not heard of larger raises at the true seed stage, as in I have an idea, I have a team, we need some money to get going so we can quit our jobs, is rare. But investors are taking too much equity. I'm an investor. I would love more equity. But the reality is, if you want an ecosystem to go, people need to be motivated. And if I'm giving away 30 to 50% slug immediately, and then I'm semi-successful, which is maybe 1% of the companies will be traditionally successful, maybe 2% if you're lucky and have good mentorship and good network and community, blah, blah, blah. Then you go raise again, you sell another 20%. Now you're at 50%. You're probably already lost the majority of your company, right? That's really demotivating. And so at a core, I think Taiwan needs to open up somehow. I don't have a clean answer for this, but if you look at Y Combinator, you look at 500 startups, you look at Techstars, you look at Spark Labs, there are these accelerator systems that have been trained around the world for years, and they take somewhere between 5 and 10%, and they give you enough money to quit your job, to actually quit your job. Sub-commentary here is a lot of entrepreneurs I find here in Taiwan are not committed. They are doing a job, and this is a side hustle. Side hustles are uninvestable for the most part, unless you are Elon Musk or Jack Dorsey, right? The rarity there is incredible. If you think you are that awesome, sorry, chances are you're probably not. And so you should focus. Can you build an awesome business if you focus? Significantly higher probability. Significantly higher probability. And you have to find co-founders. Solo founder probability, very low. You have to find co-founders that you trust, that complement you. Those are the basics. Yeah, I know we're running out of time. There's many more thoughts there, but I think this is, for a starting position, I think that would be helpful.
Okay, well, one final question then. So is Taiwan, in your experience, a good place to hire and invest?
Oh, I've invested only for a few years here. I would say the teams here are brilliant. I think the talent here is amazing. I am excited. We're about to hire a bunch of people here for MetaTheory. We're continuing to hire here for MetaTheory, both on the blockchain side, engineering side, general engineering side, game development side, art, everything, storytelling, music. And so far the talent has been awesome. I see a humble offer way to say it is I feel very similar to meeting all the talent I met when I got to San Francisco. And I think it's just a systems problem. It is an ambition. It's an ambition disconnect, and a goal disconnect, right? And so that's what we're hoping to change here.
Kevin Lin, co-founder of MetaTheory. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Samson. Thanks, everybody.